Welcome back, Guardian, to another episode of Grandmaster Building with your host, Ristophilus. In today's video, we're going to be talking about Lucky Pants, which had an insane rework this season with its crazy 600% buff. This isn't going to be a video where I'm just melting a bunch of targets. The main focus here is going to be Grandmaster and Overload champions this season, which are going to be more of the bitch to deal with. So when it comes to Lucky Pants, it's a great choice to take on those Overload champions, but what's the ultimate way to build it out? Because it's also the entirety of combat that matters, not just single targets. So let's start off by just discussing what Lucky Pants are doing, in case you just haven't heard for any reason. Lucky Pants, or an exotic leg armor piece for hunters, a legally modded holster. What that means is basically, if you have a fully loaded hand cannon that deals both kinetic or the same subclass burn that you're on. So let's say that you use Ariana on a solar subclass. You pull out that fully loaded Ariana, the left-hand side of your screen, you'll see a legally modded holster. Each shot you land will ramp up in damage and finalize at 600%. Reload it, put it away, or use the auto-loading holster, let there be a 10-second cooldown, and then repeat the process. So because of this insane buff, no shit, everybody's going to be using Ariana's Vow. But what I wanted to find out is, Ariana Vow, the ultimate choice when it comes to Lucky Pants, because it is going to be tied to Solar Subclass. So let's talk about Solar Subclass. When it comes to that class, I like the mid-tree. I've just never liked Golden Gun for PvE combat. And the reason being is because it's not always just about the super that a subclass has. I mean, yes, that does waste some part of it, but the perks in the subclass tree can have more build opportunities than other subclass trees, basically. So that's why I like Burning Edge, because every time I don't kill a target, which happens all the time in Grandmaster Combat, I will get my dodge back. And because of that, I can pair it with things such as Gambler's Dodge. I would much rather save a minute or more of my time getting my melee back than the 2 or 3 seconds back that Marksman Dodge will give me. So I always go Gambler's Dodge. And because of Gambler's Dodge and the melee coming back, I can use things like Impact Induction, which is going to give me 6 to 10 seconds off my grenade every melee hit that I get. But if I was using something that just had a punch melee, I wouldn't build out Impact Induction because the percentage of me using that perk is going to be very low in Grandmaster. But because I have a ranged melee, I can take a tier 5 59 second grenade all the way down to 35 seconds on average, saving 24 seconds. Along with impact induction, I'm also going to be using high energy fire with that 20% damage buff to go with whatever hand cannon that I'm going to be using or all the weapons that I'll be using, as well as an overload bow, because it's really crucial to take control of overload champions to prevent their health from recovering. On top of an overload bow, I'm also going to be using thermoclastic strike. Every time I use my knife on a champion, it stuns them and then refunds my knives, which goes back to having impact induction. So how that all synergizes together with the build and with Gambler's Dodge is all going to make sense once the build's all pieced together and how everything will rotate around each other. Don't make the mistake of just relying on thermoclastic strike. Here's an example of why using thermoclastic without an overload bow. You can see with even Lucky Pants, I'm still not able to take this champion out, and I did drop my light level to Grandmaster level. However, these are still Master level adds, which still aren't going to heal themselves or recover as fast as Grandmaster adds. Now let's stack it with Withering Heat with that 30% damage buff. When it comes to the energy usage you have left over, I would recommend Empowered Finisher or Shield Break Charge if you're doing something that's high shielded activity, like Legendary Lost Sector has a ton of, you know, different type of shielded enemies. Grandmaster usually doesn't, but I would use it in Empowered Finisher with that one extra point or towards your stats, whichever. This damage test is just going to show Thermoclastic Strike with Ariana's and just with Withering Heat without the Lucky Pants buff. And again, you can see it only takes it to half health and he immediately starts recovering himself. Ariana's does a lot of damage, but you'll notice the shot rate and hard to tame shot pattern doesn't allow you to really achieve the max damage with Lucky Pants that often. It really depends on the situation, but here I only got to a x9, where with other hand cannons I can get to a x11. That is kind of a trade-off because Ariana does a shitload of damage, but when it comes to taking out an overload champion and using Withering Heat with Lucky Pants, I would recommend stunning them twice with the bow first and then go in for the kill shot, such as right here. In this clip, I have Ariana's, Lucky Pants, High Energy Fire, and Withering Heat, and you can see it does a ton of damage. But it's important to understand how combat actually plays out at a Grandmaster light level in something like the Corrupted versus a Scorn Overload. I'm able to get the stun and the Ariana Lucky Pants bonus damage, but because of lack of ad control, I'm insta-melted and can't melt the overload fast enough. So even though I do have a ton of DPS, as I've said a million times in the past videos, DPS will never equal add control. Even with that amount of DPS, I still can't one phase kill an overload champion. Now for sure, Ariana is going to have a ton of situations versus single targets while you're on a team, and I definitely would never hate on somebody for using Lucky Pants and Ariana, but I want to show the reality of situations that can happen. You pretty much don't have any add control when it comes to using an overload bow and Ariana by itself. On single targets, it's going to shine quite a bit on teams, but when Grandmaster launches, I just don't want you to have the assumption that you're going to be playing the same way that you have been in Master Nightfalls and Legendary Lost Sectors and tanking all these targets by yourself. This is how it's going to be playing. I'm not saying that I'm ever going to hate on anybody that uses Ariana and Lucky Pants, because I will definitely appreciate the extra DPS, but what I'm trying to say is when you have a lot of adds that scatter around and you're only focused towards bigger targets, that's the balance and trade-off in the game, is the more DPS, the less add control and situational control you get. And that advice is one of the most crucial ones that I can give you when it comes to Grandmaster gameplay or building, is knowing and being aware of the combat situations you're going to face from experience before you get into them, and how to get the most use out of the perks on your armor based on the loadout that you're going to be using. And that's what I want to talk about in the next part of this video, is how you can keep a high Charge of Light perk rate going throughout the entire Grandmaster to keep your Lucky Pants build functioning, and most of all, dominating every situation that you encounter. Before we start, I want to say that I apologize because I never make legendary weapon specific builds, but for this build to function properly, you definitely need an auto-loading holster primary hand cannon such as Dire Promise. As far as your main perk, aside from auto-loading, use Explosive Rounds or Osmosis. Just make sure that it has the auto-loading holster and put a major spec on it. The reason being, you don't want to really do a backup mag on this because 11 round times the magazine perfectly with Lucky Pants timer, so it helps when buff tracking, you know when it's empty, it's already gone, and with 140 hand cannons, you can easily spam them and remain on target to easily get the buff. Now I'm going to go over legendary energy bow perks and ones that I recommend. There's really only one that I recommend for Grandmaster, and that's Frenzy, because it has the most playtime proc in use in GMs. That means that you're going to be in encounters for longer than you are in Master and Legendary levels, so having that extra 15%, plus if you're doing a damage spec on top of that, getting around 22%, it's definitely noticeable when you're doing add clear phases, and it speeds that process up. Now I want to show you the auto-loading holster cannon, and how much easier I can take out overload champions, and how much damage this shit's doing. As soon as I get to times 11, look at the health meter, he's almost dead. And even in clutch situations, by having that faster draw speed bow, 540 is what I always recommend. I have a 576 though with Wolf Tone draw. When you enter Grandmaster level activities, timing and perfection is more crucial than it is in Master and Legendary gameplay. So when it comes to the subtleties of how much damage you're getting chipped off your meter, or how much resistance you're getting on your resist mods, how much damage output you're getting, how many times your perks are proccing and charging you with light, how fast your health recovery is coming back, your subtle movements from your mobility speeds, all of this stuff is on a Grandmaster level, and that's what it's meant for if you want to play at a Grandmaster pace. And what I'm demoing in this segment here is just the kind of mobility and movement that I have to still be able to move around adds even with health recovery turned off. I can still move around adds and still land my shots while still doing a ton of damage. So although I'm not going to have the total Ariana package of damage, I'm still going to be doing plenty of damage with Dire Promise, and I'm going to have unlimited ammo, which means more uptime with Lucky Pants from the start to finish in a Grandmaster. I'm going to have more agility, whereas Ariana is going to have much limited movement and limited accuracy in comparison. And that, on top of the other things we're going to be talking about, should definitely not be overlooked. Let me show you another test that I conducted using Dire Promise versus Ariana when it comes to overloads and going back to the timing in Grandmasters. So check this out. I'm going to pause it when I get to a specific damage point and a specific time damaging the overload. You can see that 11 rounds times perfectly as I said earlier, so you get the max amount of damage out with that hand cannon in that time period, and that's at 8 seconds of damage and a half second before a Grandmaster overload would have started healing himself had I not hit him with an overload bow or another overload knife. Now let's do that same test again with Ariana's Vow and with Withering Heat, that same 8 seconds, and let's track the damage on it. This test is kind of important because it shows you how a slower firing hand cannon with Lucky Pants is unable to get all of its damage out because of how fast the Lucky Pants timer will go and how fast it takes an overload to heal in Grandmaster. I was able to get 8 out of 9 rounds out, which wasn't the full damage. I was able to get a times 11 with the 140 Dire Promise, and you can see the damage, even though it is a little bit more. You have to remember the time it took for me to throw the grenade, to proc the Withering Heat damage, to then swap to Ariana, and then try to fit in 9 rounds, which I only got 8 out. Even though on paper it'll show that Ariana's is doing more damage, in a sense, it didn't really do any more damage at all, really none at all, considering I wasted that entire magazine, and that goes back to the importance of timing in Grandmasters. Let's talk about the stasis fragments that I recommend for this build. Whisper of Chains, plus 10 recovery, reduced damage when near frozen targets or an ally crystal. Whisper of Durance, making dustfall grenades last longer, which is crucial. And Whisper of Torment, which is going to give you grenade recharge every time you're damaged. And of course, Dustfield allows the most control for champions or adds in Grandmaster. Touch of Winter, make the crystal in the middle of Dustfield. It also grants 2 fragments, and then the dodge to slow opponents or freeze them if you do 2 dodges in combination with Gambler's Dodge. The weapon that I recommend go with your primary auto-loading hand cannon is Le Monarch this season because it handles overload champions, and the poison arrows can actually stagger multiple champions. When you draw right and release the poison, it can splash onto other champions around. So think about Exodus Crash and all the overloads there. This weapon is the best way to control overload champions this season. And on top of that, you have unlimited ammo with both of these weapons, whereas if you have Ariana's, you're not only stuck to a solar subclass, which has limited control for champions and adds, you're also stuck to a limited amount of ammo, which is then going to take space for your heavy finders or your heavy scavengers, or you'll have to wait on the game to feed you ammo, or require a teammate to use a special finisher. So although Ariana is doing a lot of damage, it's locked to a solar subclass, which has less champ and add control, has limited ammo, and when it comes to Lucky Pants and Dire Promise auto-loading, you're still getting a lot of damage, which I'm going to demonstrate later. So let me show you how all this ties together. I'm going to show a screenshot of the build right here, so you can screenshot it now, or you can slide over to my About section, click on Discord Become Beast, and join for free, and download them in 4K under the Rusto Builds page. To save time, I'm just going to put up all the perks in the build up on one screenshot right here and just walk through it basically. So the helmet is going to have a heavy finder and dynamo. So since you have Gambler's Dodge and since you're also going to be on stasis, you're going to get these back a lot because you also have Resonant Siphon on, which means every time you stun an overload champion, it gets a great recharge rate to your abilities. So you can keep spamming this and getting your super back and use an overload to charge your super on. It's also going to have Pro Light with that 50% damage reduction. Moving on to the arms, we have Impact Induction, which we talked about earlier, the grenade energy. This also synergizes with Gambler's Dodge and Resonant Siphon. You also have High Energy Fire for a 20% damage buff on top of the Lucky Pants buff. And then to get Charge of Light so these work, that moves on to your chest piece and your leg. So the chest piece is always going to have the 2 resist mods. It might be Void in CD or Sniper in CD or 2 CD. It all depends and will adapt per GM that you're going to be doing. We're also going to be having stacks on stacks. So every time you get Charge of Light, you're going to get Charge of Light times 2. This way you're not always losing your Charge of Light every time you get a kill with High Energy Fire. You still have an extra one to get Pro Light active, and the balance of both of these perks in combination always works out better with stacks on stacks instead of losing your Protective Light ability every time you get a High Energy Fire kill. For your leg piece, of course, we're using Lucky Pants. We're also going to use Better Already instead of Recuperation because we need it to be a Void leg piece. Better Already is by no means better than Recuperation, but with the points you have left over, it's the best option out of Void Affinity because of the affinity required to use Charge Harvester. Instead of using something like Precision Charge, where Precision Hand Cannon kills can charge you with Light, it's better to have Charge Harvester and take the stat reduction because you get Charge of Light more often when using a bow and a hand cannon or any type of kill, whether it's an assist or, you know, a grenade kill, a super kill, anything can charge you with Light, and it averages every 4 to 5 kills instead of having to get 3 rapid kills using hand cannons and stuff, which is not going to happen as often in Grandmaster because of the health difference of Grandmaster adds. You're always going to get Charge of Light better with Charge Harvester, which again is going to charge you with Light times 2 to go with High Energy and then Protective Light. And then finally, we have Taking Charge, which again is going to charge you with Light times 2. So you have the option of Taking Charge and Charge Harvester to go with Resonant Siphon and Thermo Strike, which again is going to go with the Impact Induction, which is going to go with your Gambler's Dodge, and it's going to stun champions. So the total control you're going to have and the Charge of Light average you're going to have is going to be higher than any other average with that weapon combination. And this build also still works with Ariana's Vow and the Solar subclass. All you have to do is swap out Resonant Siphon with Withering Heat and put on Empowered Finisher because you won't have enough energy left over to keep taking charge. So if you still want to use Ariana's Vow, by all means do so. I'm not hating on that build at all. Still does a lot of work, especially if you're on a team setting. But when it comes to your survival rate, your total champ control, total ad control, Stasis, unfortunately, is just overkill in PvE. This is actually the first build where I haven't really focused on stats as much, because the build and the perks itself and the damage that this build does and the control it does with Stasis weighs so much on this build, it can afford you for not having as much room with stats. You'll understand more of what I mean when you piece the build together and you see how much energy everything costs to put on the armor build. So you might not have the right stats right away. It's still a really good build, but just put it on your list of things to do or something to grind towards to watch it evolve over time as you get better and better stat drops from playing Geom or just playing the game in general. If you decide to go with the solar version of this build and you're using Withering Heat, I highly recommend using Swarm Grenade, just for the fact that it won't waste your grenades like the other grenades might have a potential of doing, and it can tag multiple stacked overload champions like Exodus Crash. The reload speed I talked about earlier with Dire Promise, here's a side by side of what the reload speed looks like. It takes 3 seconds to reload a Dire Promise type hand cannon or a 140, that averages around 3 seconds. So take situations like this, stun a champ with your knives or your overload bow, you pull out Dire Promise, get all those lucky shots out, the 11 shot magazine with major spec and the illegally modded holster timer will time out perfectly if you're spamming it. Then you're free to move around and dodge, do more damage. You're not wasting 3 seconds trying to reload it and then throw it back. You'll have way more time to keep doing DPS, and the champions will have less time to heal themselves. And don't forget, illegally modded holster is excellent at doing ad clear, especially when you're walking around or having to jump around and shoot your weapon, which is a trait Ariana's doesn't have, but you can see with illegally modded holster that Dire Promise, even at a 140 hand cannon, can still rush through a group of ads and start making orbs to keep healing you because of better already and for taking charge. Even orange bar ads that are shielded enemies, just match the shield with your bow. If you need to use a Frenzy bow instead of Le Monarch, you still have that option as well. Frenzy is still doing a lot of damage. Here's Dire Promise versus an orange bar. So one magazine would never take out an orange bar at GM level, and that was a pretty far distance to still be able to kill it in that many shots. Here's an example of the Stasis knives and impact induction far away, topping that grenade off, and then charge harvester kicking in because of a legally modded holster just melting through these GM level adds. Right here I get x2 charge of light, but then my shield breaks, attrition's on, so I'm not gonna be healing. I actually like doing build tests when attrition's on because it lets me know how much resistance I'm getting. You can see 75% resistance from sniper damage resistance and the protective light resistance. It's really easy to get an assist or to get a kill in a GM, especially with illegally modded being procced, so you're going to be getting charge of light all the time with this on. High energy fire on this build really isn't necessarily meant to go with the hand cannon. It's usually just meant for like after you use illegally modded. The idea behind using high energy fire on this build wasn't necessarily meant for the hand cannon and illegally modded. It was meant for when your illegally modded ends, you can swap to Le Monarch or whatever bow you're using and have bonus damage on bigger targets because it doesn't fall off until they die, or just have a faster time to kill on smaller type adds. Now I want to show you how you kill an anti-barrier using the Stasis version of this build. So if you're doing like an overload and anti-barrier or unstoppable anti-barrier nightfall, whatever the situation, this is how you would do it. You get their health to about halfway between the symbol and their full health, as you can see in the picture. What you want to do is you want to throw your dust field on it and then spam all the lucky shots on it until you got to reload. If you don't have both of your throwing knives, like in this situation, I only have one, so I do gambler's dodge to make it two, and then I pop the ice off of him, refreeze him by using both of those throwing knives. And during all of that process, you'll have your out of luck cooldown ready. So then you just spam Lucky Pants on him again, he'll be in a finisher state, and then you just finish the anti-barrier champion. It's as simple as that. No anti-barrier needed. I want to show you the crazy synergy combos you can do on overload champions, or any target in general basically that can be frozen. So here's Resonant Siphon with impact induction with Gambler's Dodge. You'll see that I freeze him, and I keep doing the stun so you can see my abilities keep recharging themselves. I can keep freezing him back again with my throwing knives if I wanted to. It's going to give the grenade back even faster on top of Resonant Siphon. If I need my dodges back, all I got to do is a simple Gambler's Dodge. I don't even need it in this situation. Thermoclastic is always going to give your knives back, so you can keep doing impact induction after impact induction. There is a 6-second cooldown. And on top of this, if I didn't have my supercharge, I also have Dynamo on my helmet, as I talked about earlier, so I can keep using him to keep charging my super over and over again until I feel like killing him to have my super fully charged for an upcoming encounter. Now I want to take you back to the beginning of the Corrupted that I showed you earlier using Solar and Ariana, how I had no ad control basically, and you can see the situation is a lot differently when you have the Stasis version of this build on. Impact Induction, the Resonant Siphon, the controlling of the ads and bundling them all together and killing them instantly. And that's why I stress so much on the channel about balancing builds, because as I've said a million times even earlier, just because you have a high DPS weapon doesn't mean you can control situations with that weapon, and that's what build balancing and GM building is all about, is being able to tailor everything to situations and have the highest percentage outcome to get you charged with light, to make your perks work and benefit for you majority of the time, and that's what you get out of this build that I'm showing you today. Here's one last combo if you want to get a lot of Withering Heat grenades. Take Withering Heat, take Bomber, take your Lamonarch, and take the Mid-Tree Solar subclass with Gambler's Dodge using the Burning Edge perk. Still keep the Overload Bow on and the Impact Induction. Some of you who are longtime viewers probably know where I'm going with this, but I showed this in a video long ago, the best Hunter Dodge builds. When you use Lamonarch with Mid-Tree Solar, it triggers the Burning Edge effect, and because of this, you keep getting your dodge back twice per poison arrow that you fire onto a target. So basically, you just keep spamming Bomber, using Gambler's Dodge to get your knives back, and keep doing Impact Inductions, and you get a ton of Withering Heat grenades. You can also still use Dynamo, but you're not going to get the same type of freezing control that Stasis has with Dynamo. So for that reason, I probably wouldn't recommend this build for a Grandmaster kind of event or anything, but it is a fun build to mess around with. It also works with a lot of other different types of weapons, such as Jotun, Prometheus Lens, there's a ton of other ones. I'll link the video in the description, or also in the top right up here if you want to check it out. But you can see how it takes a tier 5 grenade down to only 21 seconds, and every time you get a poison arrow to go off, it recharges your dodge twice, so you can do the dodge twice and keep getting the grenades back, and like I said, spam Bomber, spam Impact Induction. You don't really need Thermoclastic Strike because of the fact that it gives your dodge back and you can just keep doing Gambler Dodge over and over. And the Bomber's kind of needed to make Withering Heat grenades come back faster. That way you're not solely relying on Impact Induction, which would then result in around a 35 second grenade on average, being at a tier 5. Of course, the higher the tier, the better. Work on the stats and grind those out. This is probably going to be a true in-game type of build, meaning you might not get the stats for a long time because of how much energy this build is going to eat up, and how much it requires naturally high statted armor to get your stats at the Ristoffelis tier 7 law. But Guardian, that's pretty much it today. I hope you enjoy beasting out in this season's Grandmaster. I don't really know if I'm going to be ready or not. I've been doing nothing but building. That's all I've really enjoyed lately, so I've been skipping out on a ton of pinnacles every week. I've probably maybe done 4 pinnacles over a 3-week period. I've just been dropping my light and playing Master and just building my ass off because it's a great season for building. But I definitely appreciate you stopping by to watch. Hit subscribe to see more content. If you want to join the Beast Squad to help my channel grow and give me time to make more content for you bros, you can also swipe over and check out merch if you'd rather get a souvenir. You can also enlist in Beast Squad by donating at paypal.me/Ristoffelis to get the Ristoffelis Skeleton Build Collection. If you're interested and want to read more about that, swipe over to the community tab and you can read all about it. But other than that, Guardian, it's been my pleasure once again. Thanks for your continued support, but it's time for me to get back out into the field. Shout out to the Beast Squad, and I'll see you all in the next video next time.